Heyo everybody, Haku here with this week's HaQ&A video, and this one I'm hopefully going to try to get through without it being an hour long or anything, but there are a lot of really sort of topics that I feel like I could talk on a lot of these individual topics for like 15-20 minutes alone if I wanted to, if I went into complete and full detail on them. So I'm going to try to not talk about these for a full hour. But there's just so much that I gotta talk about from the comments. And even before I get into that, there are a few things I actually wrote down this time, because you know where I'm like, I always think of stuff during the week where I'm like, yo, I really need to talk about this, or at least bring this up in the HaQ&A. Bam, I actually wrote it down this time so that it actually sort of kind of works out. Now, there may be more anime. I just wrote down more anime. But what I meant by that is... starting off this, I may be covering some more anime on the channel, because I'm gonna continue, at least for now, covering Yojo Senki week to week, because so many people said they wanted me to continue it, despite not thinking the first episode was very good. So yeah, I'm continuing it. I'm gonna give it a chance to see if it improves. The first episode, probably to me, will always be a bit of a flop, but who knows, it could get much better after that, despite the first episode not being so hot. Then, of course, we've got, why am I even looking at that? There's nothing even written there. Hold on, let me fix this lighting. Is that even better? It looks really bad to me. But either way, I digress. Okay, so we're going to be covering that still. Of course, we're going to be covering Little Witch Academia, because I loved it and I was expecting to love it. But also, I really want to check out that interview with a monster girl, or Demi-chan, it's something with a K. So whatever, interview with the monster girl, I want to check out that. I don't know if I'll review it week to week, but I'll at least check it out. And maybe I will, who knows. I don't want to do so many anime. But I want to check that out, and I also want to check out a few others. Maybe check out that Maid Dragon anime, and I don't know if I'll make any videos on any of them, or if I'll cover them week to week. I just want to check them out and see what happens. Or maybe it won't be week to week. Maybe like I'll just skip 3 weeks if I don't have time, and then just... when I do have time, spam the reviews for the three weeks I missed, something like that, because a lot of other channels aren't really consistent and stick to a certain timetable, so I don't think it should be that bad if I don't stick to a timetable with some stuff. So yeah, I'm going to maybe be covering up to four anime this season, depending on how it goes. There are just a lot I want to check out and see how they go. Also, I told you guys my New Year's resolution was to not work myself to death, and then like day three into January, I was like, oh, I totally failed that. Because of all the crap going on with school, all that is seemingly sorted out. I still have a bunch of crap to do there. I still have to do actual school every day starting this week. Plus, I have to do YouTube as well, so I am working myself pretty rough, but... because of that, I decided, you know what, I'll pick up a new New Year's resolution, even though I've never believed in them before. Just some things that I kind of want to do. And one thing that over the course of last year, I caught myself wanting to do and wishing I could do more and more. I was like, you know, man, I was like, I wish I could better understand certain languages. Like, the big ones for me that would help out in my daily personal life would definitely be Japanese and, to a lesser extent, Spanish. And the thing is, when I, this is going to be a little bit of a story time, but when I first went to college, I had the choice. I had to take a foreign language, and I had the choice between Japanese and Russian. So I was like, I'm never, ever going to use Russian. I'm probably not going to use Japanese. But I was like, you know what? At that point in my life, I had seen a couple of anime maybe, and I was like, you know, I've seen a couple of anime. I'll just... pick up Japanese, just do a class on it or whatever. So I learned, like, from doing that to fulfill my college credits, I just learned to read and write katakana and hiragana. I learned a few kanji. I learned a couple, like, basic sentence structure type things. So definitely far from speaking it or reading it, but I can actually make things out decently well. I don't know the word for it. Like, if it's just written in katakana and hiragana, or if it's, like, the kanji with the little hiragana written above it, I can read that and sort of make out what they're trying to say. That's what, like, when the DMN Mamusu game was coming out, I could read that in the tweets. It would take me a bit, but I was able to make that out and tell, like, what characters they were introducing and stuff like that. So I was like, okay, it would be helpful, because there are a lot of mangaka and different things that I follow that I'm like, I would love to be able to actually truly understand and read what they are saying and be able to communicate with these people and these artists that I follow as well. So I'm like, that would really help me in my daily life. But I'm like, Japanese is a really tough freaking language. So what am I gonna friggin' do about that? I don't know if I can do it. So to build my confidence a bit, I was like, you know what? There's the American embassy registry or something like that, saying for their people that they send out and stuff, what the least to most difficult languages are for English speakers to learn. And like Spanish is one of the easiest because we share a bunch of the same grammar rules and have pretty similar words for most things. So I was like, you know what? Spanish would also be very helpful because I've had a lot of people in the past comment in Spanish and I've just sort of had to try to make out what they were saying and then respond in English and say, hopefully they run that through the Google Translate. But so hopefully to make it easier to maybe be able to read those comments actually. And like, there's a lot of you that speak Spanish as your first language and a lot of people that comment pretty actively that do speak that as their first language and aren't the best with English, so I'm like, it would be a lot easier for them if I could read them and answer them back in their native language. So you know what, it would really help, and it would help in real life situations too, because like, there's this one story of this guy in real life. He went up to me and he was trying to find this place, but he didn't speak any English, only Spanish, and he was like showing me text messages all in Spanish, and I had to try to figure out what he was doing to give him directions or whatever. So it would just be a lot easier in general, just because there are so many people here in America that do speak Spanish, and it would help a lot with comments and stuff, being able to talk to you guys, and then maybe, I don't know, I think it would just be helpful. It would definitely open more opportunities, and same for sure with Japanese, but I'm going to learn Spanish first, so I've been working on it for the past 2 weeks, and I think I'm hoping by the end of this semester of school to get to a point where I can at least be conversational with it and answer you guys back and forth in the comments and stuff if that's what you need or prefer. So yeah, that's what I'm going for, and maybe after that, if I'm feeling like I can do it, I will try to actually learn Japanese. But I think that it may not be as hard since I do already know a little bit of Japanese. At least I can get some, I can kind of halfway read and write, so I think it would not be the most difficult thing ever. Next up, the Maho Shoujo Weekse Keikaku read-through that a bunch of you have said you wanted a lot. I have no clue, no earthly idea when I'll be able to do that. Like I said, school, all these videos, behind on stuff. I'm gonna try to find a time to do that once a week, but I have no idea when yet. Nope, no clue yet. Still working on it, though. Maybe next week I'll have a better answer. Also, just seeing so many things and how you reacted to a lot of my videos this week, I really gotta throw out there that I really love and appreciate you guys. Like, sometimes I feel like I'm like, I do not deserve people this great in my life, because I made a really negative review of something that I figured a lot of you would really love. And though a lot of you did agree with me that Yojo Senki was bad or disappointing, the people, even the ones that disagreed, really were very kind and respectful about it, and I was expecting at least one or two comments to just be hate, blah, you're stupid, you don't know what you're talking about, but no, it was very, very well received, and I thank you guys for that a ton. Okay, next thing I wanted to bring up just real quick before I get into the comments. Two things real quick. First up, the Walking Dead videos. I'm trying to do them once a week, but holy God, it's hard to think of topics. There is like pretty much nothing going on right now for me to think of a topic. I'm going to try to make something this week, but if you guys have any suggestions at all for a topic for that, please, please tell me, because it would help me out a lot for these weeks when I don't have a topic, like this week where I am struggling to think of a topic and I've got nothing and I wanted to post it by Friday or maybe even sooner. I don't even know when I plan to post it, because Friday now we're going to be doing the Yojo Senki reviews. I have no clue, guys. I have no clue what I'm doing. Also, last thing, the trailers recently came out for the second season of Shingeki no Kyojin and Boku no Hero Academia, and I'll be watching both of those week to week. I think next season is when they come out, so or maybe the season after that. I think it's next season, though. But so yeah, when I do watch those week to week, I was wondering, if maybe this week or next week, probably not until next week is when I'd have time. I haven't watched the trailers yet. Do you guys want me to do a live reaction discussion for each of them? Like, for each of the videos, I would watch the trailer for my first time, and then I would have a discussion at the end of it after I watched it my first time and reacted to it. That's up to you guys if you guys think that's something you would want, but just throwing it out there as a possibility. Hopefully, I don't know, hopefully I wouldn't get any copyright strikes for stuff like that if I'm discussing it, but you never know these days, really. And that's it. Yeah, so let's get into talking about stuff for the comments. Yeah, I already had one person say they wanted me to do a video on the Boku no Hero Academia trailer, so I will at least probably be doing that. Just wondering if any of you wanted me to try Shingeki no Kyojin's trailer as well to talk about that. For the two of them, I do believe I've read enough to know, I've already read up to what Season 2 will likely cover for Boku no Hero Academia, and as well for Shingeki no Kyojin, because I think I read the manga for that up to chapter 50-something, so I think that's where I am with that. So getting into discussing actual comments at, 10 minutes in, Yurazuya White Bear Beppo said 3 hours of sleep daily grinding on that mangaka schedule, and yeah, like I said, YouTube was a dream I wanted to chase, kind of, and I really wanted to put more time into it after just a little while of doing it, because I really saw the reactions of you guys being positive, and really just wanted to be part of this channel. I don't know, I feel like I'm kind of living my dream every day, but to be able to do this every day and live my dream, and to still be able to go to college full-time and stuff, I had to make a ton of friggin' sacrifices. But, I did say last week, I really hope my I really hope I can pace myself and schedule myself better this year so that I can still do this, still do school, and then work out and lose the weight that I gained last semester and get back into shape. So I can work out, I can improve the video some, hopefully, I can actually sleep, and maybe even have some free time, but dealing with my school last week, and still continuing on is really hurting that hope a little. And Carlos Tellez said, I hope you find a steady pace, thanks a ton, and I feel like I'm going to be able to do it this semester. Today was really a litmus test, and I'm behind schedule today as is, but I'm still hoping to have everything I wanted to get done today done, plus have just an hour or two of free time, and I really need to work more on that Mamusu Waifu video, but I have just had so little time to work on it this week, and last week as well with all I was going through with my school, that it was crazy how little I was able to work. But either way. Thank you guys, and moving on. Yuri Zahard said it's very unlikely for Baam to climb alone, so SIU has to find a way sooner or later to balance the power-ups, like taking the thorn away would be the easiest way. My biggest problem with the shonen issue that you're talking about is how, if the main character grows too fast, the companions become sort of useless. The story would really suffer if Baam's superpowers wouldn't be limited for specific situations, like the Baam vs. Joaquin power-up being limited to that situation, or restricted by the rules and the world physics, like how many items are limited on a floor number. Or how items are limited by the floor number. By the way, the most important part of the chapter is Kun realizing he's in love with Baam, and the man love is growing strong. But yeah, I agree with what you said about the power-up issue. It's fine if it's limited and everything has weight and consequence, and minor characters are still important. It's just that sometimes I feel like we slip a tiny bit from that. The Gaming Wolf said, about The Walking Dead, I have some good theories that could go down, tell me your thoughts on them. And this is kind of dealing with the comics, so we don't even know if it'll happen anywhere near the same in the show, but you might just want to skip ahead a little bit if I'm still talking about this, if you are a show-only watcher and don't want to know what happens in the comics. But they said, I have some good theories that could go down, tell me your thoughts on them. I personally think that Rick, Dwight, Negan, and a group will maybe be held up in a house like in No Way Out, and I think Laura may mention stealing the Whisperer strategy due to her saying it'd be cool if they kept using it. I think Rick and Dwight will lead a group out of Alexandria with the skins on. Now, this may not happen, but I think that Andrea will be on the tower watching, sniping the dead out, and I think as she's sniping, she may see the Whisperers in her scope, and she may kill some, or the Whispers, and she may kill someone from our group thinking that they are Whispers, and that is what the issue 162 cover is maybe hinting at. And the issue 163 cover with Rick's hand could mean just signifying that he's going to be a Whisperer in disguise, in my mind. It could go down many ways. I think that 164 will be Rick and Dwight meeting up with Maggie in the Hilltop, and I have a feeling that's where Negan and Maggie will reunite again. I think that William will offer shelter at the Kingdom to our remaining group, and with Zachary that could cause problems because of Rick. I'm also confident that 164 will be the issue where the Saviors will strike, but they'll see that our community lost the war. I also think that the Saviors and Whisperers will have conflict, and I think the Whisperers will be wiped out by the Saviors in one piece. For sure the Whisperers are on borrowed time. There's no way they'll make it 15 issues more. Beta, yes, maybe, but not the Whisperers, because they have to go to Ohio. I actually like those theories, and they kind of agree with a lot of what I think, because I think they are going to probably have to use the Whisperer strategy to escape. Since we've talked a bit about that in the actual series. So I think they're going to have to use that to escape. And I think a ton of people are going to get wiped out before they can. Like, that strategy, I feel like, is only going to work for a pretty small group. And also, Andrea killing the wrong person is kind of likely, too. Because back when Dwight first put on the Whisperer mask last time, I said, yo, this is dangerous. What if somebody accidentally kills him thinking he is a Whisperer? So there's that, and I already said that my personal theory, I think the Saviors are going to probably have to fight the Whisperers as well. They're going to have to give up their betrayal storyline and be like, okay, we kind of need to team up. Let me get some water right quick. Zinnowheel said, I have hope in the soul power-up, talking about Baam again. After defeating Joaquin at the Dollar Show, he said that the power disappeared, but Albelda said the souls will aid him in the future. If Joaquin gets sealed off for good or killed, there's no reason for the souls to continue existing in Baam because Baam would be a prison for them. They have no incentive to haunt the living world anymore with Joaquin gone. So yeah, that power-up hopefully goes away later on, which is two. And yeah, from what we've seen right now, the soul power-up is dormant anyway, in some sort of way. It'll probably help him later on, but the soul power-up I don't have a huge problem with. Because though it happened really, really quick and though it was a little OP, the soul power-up makes sense for what was going on in the story and everything. And sorry, I keep wiping that hair out of my face. But yeah, the soul power-up kind of made sense. I just don't like this current Divine Circular Flow power-up because we really didn't need it. Because Baam losing his allies like that, he wasn't going to take down a Slayer candidate just like that. It was... I don't want to say it was completely circumstantial, but it was circumstantial enough that I think that giving Baam a power-up here isn't totally justified. Latroy's view said about the Walking Dead comics, the only defense I give Rick with not telling Dwight that he was that he didn't know exactly when the war would start. Other than that, it was a dick move that he didn't tell him. And yeah, it doesn't make sense that Rick didn't tell anyone, especially his army, the size of the enemy army. That doesn't make a lot of sense. Jericho2Alone said, awesome video, bro. Thank you so much. It is very appreciated. Tony John said about, and here's where we're going to get into the wave of Yojo Senki comments. So we're going to be talking about Yojo Senki for a little while, I think. Tony John said, I like the episode, just to let you know they kind of start the story in the middle of chapter 3 in the light novel and manga. If anything, they might be doing a kind of storytelling where we throw you in the middle of a big event and you have no clue what's going on, then we flash back to what led up to that event, and this is only going to be a 12-episode series and the chapters of the light novel are really, really long, so I don't know how much they're going to adapt. I like the first episode, but then again, I know what's going on because I've read the original source material. Animation-wise and character art design, yes, it could have been better, but the original design and the light novels weren't that great either. And my personal taste, if I were you, would be to watch maybe one more episode. If nothing gets explained in a decent amount by episode 2, I would drop it. I'm going to stick till the end because I have waited for the series for a long time, and I knew that the anime would, which could be different, from the beginning, so I was really going in with a minimal mix of expectations. But if it doesn't interest you, don't force yourself. Everyone has their own different taste when it comes to shows and anime. Not to say this episode was perfect by any sense, even not a fan of the series, and you and I know it's going on knows they could have done. You and I know they could have done better on some. Got you. And give it one more chance to explain by episode 2. If not, I would drop it. But no, I didn't like the episode, but it feels like the kind of series that I would like if it was written, directed properly, I kind of think. Like, this is the sort of general idea of a show that I would really, really like. I just don't think it was handled very well. And like I said, I'll continue it for now to see if it gets better in the future. But even if it gets better, episode 1 to me will still likely be a bit of a failure. They said, yeah, that's understandable. I like the episode, but I'm not going to deny there were problems, and they could have done better in certain parts for me. It's just barely passing the mark, you know, like a 6 out of 10 for me. But then again, I read the original source material, so I knew what was going on, even if they didn't explain it. And I knew from the preview things were going to be a bit different, so I went in with minimal expectations. I would give it the 3-episode rule. And yeah, like I said, I'm going to keep watching and reviewing, and I'll probably throw in some other anime, too. East1860 said, wow, the adaptation so far is really not good. The light novel itself is pretty complex and has nothing to do with a pointless action fest. However, please keep reviewing the anime for now. The source material's good. The show just has to get better, hopefully. Maybe you could watch the first 3 or 4 episodes and decide if you want to continue. By the way, did you watch Drifters from the mangaka of Helsing? If so, how'd you like it? I really enjoyed it, since the adaptation was absolutely on point and I liked the whole concept. I'm going to give it a chance, don't worry, like I said. But yeah, hopefully the storytelling will get better. And no, I didn't watch Drifters, but I did hear pretty good things about it, so maybe at some point in the future. Andrea Zapita said, this is Azeta all over again, except they're now evil. Lol, I kinda enjoy it in some parts, but I mostly felt like meh. I don't see any character worthy of being waifu material. The design was weird, though it wasn't bad, I don't know, it was just weird. I actually personally really liked the design for Victoria and Tanya. My problems with it were the designs were all over the place, they didn't have the same art style. There was the serious art style, which is good in some cases, and if all the characters were that, that would have been fine. There's the art style of the one guy in the glasses. I don't typically like that art style, but then again, story is more important, so it would still be fine if it had a good story. I say that I like the Victoria and Tanya designs just because, I don't know, they look like they had the most put into them, even though they're not super serious. And I don't want to call it complexity, but they seem like they had a lot put in. It seems like picking, you know those anime where you're like, okay, you can pick out the main characters because they look all weird and wacky compared to the background characters. It felt like that, but to a crazy serious degree where they looked like important characters and literally every other character looked like a random background character. So, that's probably why I like their design and not the other designs. Andrew Zapita said, I'm probably not used to their designs, but you're right with how the designs are everywhere and it makes it uncomfortable. Super Shoutman said, funny enough, the writer of the source material himself didn't believe that his idea got published at all. Then Andrew Zapita said, okay, now that is sad. Andrew Zapita said, I would go with watching 2 or 3 episodes more so we can see if it gets good, but it depends because I also didn't like it. I'm going to continue giving it a chance for now. Even though I thought it was bad, if I think it's bad after like 4 episodes, then I'm assuming at that point, if I think it's bad, most of you probably will as well if it's been that long. But I'm going to continue giving it a chance. Ilham Naim said, no matter what kind of shitty mood I'm in, a cute animal video always fixes it. But those things are dangerous. Once you start, you just can't stop. Also, the rant was hilarious and sadly true. Thank you so much. I agree. YouTube suggestions have very much ruined me. I have gotten to this point where, like, I used to never click on YouTube suggestions, but they used to at least be somewhat related to what I watch. Now it's just random shit, like, not even related to what I watch, but for some reason there's so many that I'm like, I must click. I don't know. Ilham Naim also said, When Tower of God ends, if it ends, would you prefer for it to have a closed ending with a nice bow wrapped around it, or more of an open ending with the main characters still struggling, fighting, maybe climbing higher floors? Some side characters could also show up in SIU's other Tall's user stories. Tower of God just has such a wide universe, I don't think we could ever cover it all. So I would prefer an open ending, and that would let SIU continue to write his other stories. Yeah, I always prefer open endings. Just the idea to me of a story in a universe that can essentially last forever by picking up new characters. Again, Naruto, Boruto is a horrible example because Naruto kind of sucked towards the end and Boruto was pretty crap as well. But just the idea of a story, just using that as an example, if there's a universe where, like, we can carry on with it for, like, 20 years, pass on the main character torch to somebody else, carry on in that universe, I love the idea of that. So yeah, I would love that for Tower of God. Maybe do it in a different way, where, like you said, we leave it open-ended, we go to other stories in the same universe. I would definitely prefer that when it does end, it has a open end. Cycle113 said, please keep reviewing Yojo Senki for now. I think you'll enjoy more in the later episodes. Got it, no worries, continuing to give it a chance. Ilham Naim said, happy birthday, Haku. Pretty sure that's not your name. Read your tweets, hopefully I'm not being a complete fool of myself. Have a blast in the snow, make some snow angels or snowmen. Thank you so, so much. And you're not making a fool of yourself. It was my birthday and I love the snow. Snow is my favorite weather. And they said, yep, winter is my favorite weather too, and I've seen the snow a couple of times, but where I live it never snows, and it rains only twice a year. No, I'm not lying, it literally rains twice. Sometimes if we're really, really lucky, it'll rain thrice. The maximum it's ever rained in my 19 years of experience was 5 times, or the most it's rained a year. And I can't even imagine that. Where I live, it rains like probably a third of the time. Probably 1 out of 3 days it's raining here. So it's pretty crazy. Yuruzuya Waipepepo said, Kohei redrew the duo blow in the volume release for Boku no Hero Academia. I checked it out. Looks nice. He also said, All Might had his guts wrecked by All For One. Chapter 1 revealed the injury. I recommend doing a reread in the future to fully grasp the series. I'm a supporter for rereading most series. And yeah, I said it must have been an issue with the crappy Chapter 1 translation. I thought that in Chapter 1 they just sort of left it really vague what happened, like some villain that we didn't know about yet had done it, or that he overused his powers. I don't remember which I had thought, but it might be a translation issue, but I thought they just left it really vague. But either way, thank you for the clarification. So at least now I do know. Gonna move on. No Consensus said, when Karaka is leaving to head outside, there's a black sphere. Maybe it's his reviving technique, so he might die again on the floor of death and revive back to that place to open the door. I also wonder where Chang and Quietro are. We haven't seen them in quite a while. This is something else I could talk about for a bit. I love, good catch as well. I like that a lot of you caught on to things for me to go back and check out in the reread. But I love that part of Karaka's abilities. Just the thought that he just dies and sets a spawn point and respawns there. I love that. Also, I love Chang and Quietro, so I'm really interested in where they took Elliot and Angel to. But I think maybe it has something to do. I made a theory a while back. I don't think I made a separate video on it. I just talked about it either in a HaQ&A or a review. And I don't remember what triggered this theory, but I was like, I really think that Chang has some sort of relation to the Bay Road. I'm like, maybe he's the third Mad Dog and he's just been hiding that he's the third Mad Dog. But it seemed, the way he showed interest in Elliot and Angel, that he had some reason to have interest in the Mad Dogs. So whether Chang has an interest in Blood Fusion or he has some relation to the Bay Road, I just really want to see where they go with that. And if that theory is true, maybe they'll show up towards the end of the Floor of Death, or maybe at the epilogue of the Floor of Death or Hell Train, because SIU already said that the Floor of Death is going to be to the Hell Train part of the story as the workshop battle was to the first part of this Season 2 story. So if that's going to be how it is, at the end of the workshop battle, when we had the workshop battle epilogue, we got all this hype and saying, okay, we're going to the Hell Train next. So if that's the case, I'm thinking maybe when we finish the Floor of Death, a long time from now probably, at least 30 to 50 chapters, I'd assume. It's probably going to be a pretty long arc. But whenever we do finish the Floor of Death arc, I think that maybe we'll have an epilogue there that hypes us up for where we're going next in the storyline. And where we go next in the storyline maybe is the Bay Road, and maybe that's how Chang comes back with Elliot and Angel. Or maybe they just say, somebody tells them that that's where they went, and Baum's like, okay, the Bay Road is our next stop. Because we do know that we're going to be dealing with Karaka in this arc, and so maybe Karaka says something about the other Slayers, and maybe something about Baylord Yama, and so Baum's like, okay, next stop is the Bay Road. So who knows, maybe that'll be where we go next. And maybe that's where Quietro and Chang's disappearance is going to lead us to story-wise. Moving on some more. Svetislav Kolev, sorry if I pronounced your name wrong, said, the one who says, it feels like I'm leading somewhere where I absolutely have to go is Wangnan, or is not Wangnan, it's Baam. Also, I think that for the test for the 42nd floor, they took, so the translation's correct, you don't have to pass the test to go to the 43rd floor since there's no administrator. You can basically skip the floor if you want by taking a special path to the 44th floor. That's why those gatekeepers to the real Floor of Death are there, I guess, since there's no real test. There might be some sort of life form, something like a parasite which came out of the dead guardian. And the door that Karaka went is not for the rice pot. I'm almost certain that if you remember, there were no requirements to enter. Boro and his companions even said they had visited the God of Guardians before, but they were wiped. Future Guy 2045 said, good catch about it being Baam, who says the line, of course. I thought it was Wangnan, though it could be both saying it, both of them saying it. It's a weird translation. And then Svetislav Kolev said, the translation can easily mislead you, since any just describes how it works. I like the idea of both of them thinking that simultaneously, but I do think those are only Baum's thoughts. Thinking about it, Wangnan is at the point most likely, or is at this point most likely a Prince of Zahard, which pretty much wouldn't link him to the Floor of Death. Baam, on the other hand, he has part of the Thorn, which immediately links him to it. Plus, Rachel hinted that at the Floor of Death they might find out more of Baum's past. As a side note, since the train was created to be a training ground for irregulars, probably only an irregular can open the door that Karaka stumbled upon. SIU has something prepared for us in that door for sure. And yes, thank you for pointing it out, so I could pay more attention when rereading. It seems like Baam is the only one that's saying slash thinking that, but I do love the idea of both Baam and Wangnan feeling the same way, like they're being drawn there. Because I still think Wangnan may have something to do with whatever this red light is. Maybe the red light district is a place on the Floor of Death, and not just what I assumed was just artistic flourish. I would love if both of them were feeling the same way there. Also, the gatekeepers to me are very, very interesting, because it seems like, and I think I talked about it in the review, they seem like they could be a new type of creature other than a Shinhui. So it'd be cool if maybe, you said something about parasites, maybe they're like Shinsu parasites feeding off of the residual Shinsu from the Guardian's corpse. Because if the real Floor of Death is inside the Guardian's corpse, it would make sense, maybe they're like parasites living in the corpse. Also, you're right about there being no door to the God of Guardians. I went and checked. So my best guess for that door is that maybe it has some sort of connection to the hidden floor that comes at the end of the Hell Train. Andrea Zapita said about Little Witch Academia, Studio Trigger always amazes me. I'm having Kill la Kill flashbacks. I heard that the anime will have 25 episodes or something like that. I hope it does, because it's really good so far. Now this is an anime with waifu material. I hope it continues like this because I'm enjoying it so far. Thanks for the video. Thanks for the comment. Much waifu material indeed. But seriously, I thought this was only going to be 12 episodes. If this is 25 episodes, my life will be getting much, much happier, because Little Witch Academia was brilliant. Yudazuya White Bear Beppo said, I wouldn't say it's game-changing, but it's definitely enjoyable and fun. I'd say it has the potential to be game-changing. If the rest of the show can keep up the animation, the direction, the music use, and the story of the first episode, then it has a lot of potential to be the next massive anime, in my opinion. And he said keyword is game-changing. I do agree that it can be the anime of the season, though. And I don't know, because you can never really know when an anime is going to be, I don't want to say the next Madoka Magica, because Madoka Magica came around in 2011, and it broke records for, like, so much of, like, sales records and all that, and it's, like, still, I think, the third best-selling of all time, maybe, behind two other older shows. So it's still huge, so you never know when, like, it would be amazing to see the next massive, massive show like that come about. And when I say game-changing, it's kind of hard to describe what is game-changing, because a lot of the big, big shows have sort of small effects. Like, I feel like the 2011 Hunter x Hunter influenced the ability for One Punch Man to be made the way it was, and that was huge enough that it's getting a season 2 and all of that, so it really works all together in a good way. The only series I can directly think of is like, the spectrum of anime is so broad that you can't really say one certain thing is game-changing for the whole spectrum, I guess, so you are right about that. Because, like, you have something like Gundam that came about, and because of that, we still have Gundam shows and still have mecha anime to this day because of its popularity. Or something like Dragon Ball came about. There's still Dragon Ball shows being made, but Dragon Ball was really important in influencing Rurouni Kenshin and Hunter x Hunter and Yu Yu Hakusho. And those three, in return, were really, really important in influencing Naruto, Bleach, and One Piece. And those three, again, in turn, were very, very important in influencing these newer series like Boku no Hero Academia. So it is really cool how there's this chain of influence, and I feel like the most recent anime that you could call game-changing like that, and this is something I could talk about a lot, negatively is Sword Art Online. I will give it credit for that. Positively, I would say Madoka Magica. Now, to explain that before people flip out, the reason I think Sword Art Online was game-changing is because it showed that with the right marketing, you can have a really, really crappy storyline, but if you put a lot into the animation, don't even care about the storyline, just give it animation, give it tits and ass, and these little kids will eat that stuff up. And so because of that, there have been so many shows spawned afterward that have really, really good animation, essentially no story, and it's just tits and ass flopping everywhere. So yeah, I think it had a negative effect, but I do think in a way, affecting the things that are made in the future, it was game-changing. Now, Madoka Magica had an effect that I think was positive for a lot of shows that were made in the future. A lot of shows were made, they're like, oh, it's successful because it's something like Magical Girls, which have been the same forever, but they took a way dark change to it, so let's do that again. And those series are mostly not good because it's clear that they don't get what made it as big as it was. It wasn't that it was so surprising and a really good deconstruction. It was, but more than that, the art, the music, the animation, it was something very, very different, and every single second of it had something good going on, and it influenced a lot of good future anime, and I think that the way that I could feel that this does the same is because the animation is trying a lot of new things that I think will turn out really good because it looks really nice. I feel like the music was, there was constantly something really good going on with the soundtrack, whereas most shows just don't have that whatsoever. So I think there was a lot going on with Little Witch Academia that could influence future shows for the better. So that was my basic thoughts on how it's potentially game-changing. Let me grab some water again. Ilham Naim said, I don't know how to explain this exactly, but did anyone feel like this chapter of Tower of God was darker? Not darker as in the colors, but like more serious and kind of ominous and foreboding? And I did feel that as well a bit, and I loved the feeling. It felt like we as readers were in a place with the characters, feeling the creeping anticipation of what will come. It'll probably be a great storyline, but it will be very dangerous for the characters, and I felt like it was good that SIU, in his art and in the pacing, really built up that anticipation, just slowly creeping up. And I like the way we did that. We didn't go too fast for this one. I think it worked really well. They also said, I thought the train stops at the station for only 3 days, so do they need to go and come back in time to board the train, or can they just skip to... Sorry, hiccup. Can they just skip to the next floor because there's no administrator to give tests, or are they going to be stuck on that floor until the train comes back in a couple of years? You know, it's an interesting question, actually. When you pass a test... Oh, and I didn't... The person's coming earlier about the mistake with the translation. I'm sorry, I didn't address that. Hold on. I'll address that real quick. Yeah, it said that it was the test to the 42nd floor, and while it was the test on the 42nd floor, it's not the test to it. You have to take the test in order to move up to the next floor. So technically on the 42nd floor, since most regulars, and I think somebody else brought that up, can skip the floor of death, the test you take there probably gives you a right to move on all the way up to the 44th floor. Unless you're on the train, and you'll probably have to take a test on the train if you're there. So yeah. But the train stopping there for only 3 days, that, it's interesting because I had thought about it as well. I feel like we should be on the floor of death for longer than that. We should be there a while. But then again, if we do have like a 50 to 100 chapter arc, a massive, massive arc, then we could actually have that happen in the course of 3 days if it's really action-packed and detailed. So, yeah, I mean, One Piece did it with Dressrosa. Again, not the greatest thing to compare it to, because Dressrosa is one of One Piece's weaker arcs. But I think that we could do an arc that where we go, do what we need to do, and get back on the train in 3 days, and have that be 50 to 100 chapters pretty easily. So that's a possibility. Or Poropo can just have the train wait at the station for him, since he's like the sort of interim conductor right now. But no idea how it works. No clue at all. So yeah, there was something else I was thinking that maybe they could do. I don't think they would be stuck there until it comes back, though. I mean, because they could likely... I don't know. Maybe they would. I think they have to get back on the Hell Train, because if you were on the 42nd floor and passed the test, you would probably just take one of the suspended ships like we saw all the way to the 44th floor, and I doubt those things are making stops at the floor of death. The train's probably the only thing making actual stops there. And even then, it's not making an actual stop. We have to jump off because there's no station. So, yeah, it's a really interesting thing, and I'm interested to see how the story will handle it. Anime Watcher said, now that you said it, Hayura does look like a flight secretary. How'd I not catch that? I can't believe the Guardian's dead corpse can cover an entire floor. How powerful Enryu has to be. It's utterly insane. Svetislav Kolev said, exactly, since a long time ago, Enryu has been the epitome of the word irregular for me. In my opinion, irregulars are feared and disliked mostly because of him. Imagine what chaos he brought to the tower when he killed the Guardian, breaking one of the oldest rules in the tower by having a higher Shinsu control than the ultimate master of Shinsu on the floor. Look at Karaka, a ranker, or a fresh high ranker at most, and Yuri around 500th or so in the high rankers. Look at their fight and the scale of the battle. Now imagine a fight which includes Enryu, who's many times stronger than them. I would dare guess that Enryu wouldn't appear a lot in the story, since he'd be hard to draw fighting. SIU himself stated that he's an overpowered character. Personally, Enryu is my favorite irregular for now, considering that Baam might surpass him. He's even said to be the most handsome male character to ever appear, and he even battles gracefully. Being overpowered and having no info on his background, why he killed the Guardian, or where he is, or what his goal is, the mystery builds up the hype around him even more for me. And yeah, I said Smexy Smexy Yura. But I've always been in love with Enryu's story as well. Just the ability to create life itself and the ability to kill a Guardian, both incredible. SIU also did say before that Enryu will appear occasionally throughout the story. So a lot of people are saying maybe we'll just get to see him even if it's just a cameo this arc. That might be possible. Though SIU also said that his contribution to the story would have to be super limited, since Enryu was so overpowered that any storyline that had him in it would kind of struggle to be exciting because he could easily solve most problems. Like, if there was a bad guy, Enryu could easily overpower them. If there was something going on, the dude can create life and kill a guardian. There's very little that Enryu couldn't do if Baam was like, yo, I have a problem, you want to help me out? If Enryu even wanted to help Baam out. But yeah, just throwing it out, I really, really love him and some things that SIU has said in the past. Anime Watcher said, I'd like to see you react to the Boku no Hero Academia trailer sometime. It's pretty bizarre that Attack on Titan and Boku no Hero Academia are going to be the first anime I'll be watching weekly with you. I think he meant the trailer for both of them. So, awesome. I'm excited for him, and I'll probably do the reaction to those trailers then. Also, I said I was going to continue to hold off on reading the Shingeki no Kyojin manga so that it's more exciting when I watch the show. I've probably already read the parts I said earlier, like at the beginning of the video that Season 2 is covering, because I've read up to Chapter 50-something. And I don't know if the show will go any further than that. Okay, No Consensus said, I wouldn't say comparing Naruto and Baam is fair. The narratives are pretty different. And sorry to shorten this down, but it's pretty much just saying how Baam is built up to be super, super strong, and that's a big part of his narrative. And Naruto was weak, gaining this monstrous strength. He said also an interesting note that there's a two-month gap between when Baam takes the hit from the technique until he's able to form his first Bang, which is unusual in Baam's case since he usually copies moves instantly. Though I'm pretty biased because I read Wuxia novels, and it's common for main characters to go stronger all the time and get a lot of power-ups, so it doesn't bother me. Future Guy 2045 said, I agree about Naruto versus Baam, because Baam has been a genius or monster from the beginning, and he was trained over 2 months. So it was a decent training arc, it just wasn't portrayed properly, and it doesn't bother me. I do agree that the way he first used it did feel anticlimactic. I don't know what I was expecting, but it didn't excite me when he used it. And yeah, to give this example better, to like try to better explain my point, Naruto is not the best example because the characters are very, very different. Naruto is not perfectly written anyway as a character, but comparing the two story arcs of the moves works really well to show the issues with how Baam learning the Divine Circular Flow was written. The Rasen Shuriken took a lot of time that we actually saw to be written. Divine Circular Flow, it took time, it took those 2 months, but it was mostly done off-panel, and it was done in the course of like 3-4 chapters. Now, I'm not saying it should have been longer, it's just with a super overpowered move, 3-4 chapters mostly off-panel is a bit light. When Rasen Shuriken was first used, it was used as a last-ditch effort against an incredibly powerful enemy, and it had a massive, massive drawback. Of breaking the user's arm and messing with their chakra control systems. So it took a long time to develop ways to use it without a huge toll on the user. Now, with the Divine Circular Flow, the first time it is used, it's just a normal move and a test that Baam could have handled without it, arguably. Also, there was no visible drawback, and even though it is stated that it's not totally complete and he can improve the ability, it's already effective and it's usable in this state without a huge drawback to Baam. So the conclusion for all of that is that both moves were big power boosts, but Baam, when he learned it, his story got off with learning it way, way more quickly, using it really soon after story-wise, and having little to no consequence. So it was just very, very... there wasn't much weight or depth to it. It was very light and shallow. So it's two similar situations, but the writing for Baam was just less... like you said, it was less exciting. It was kind of anticlimactic. I still don't think it was a very good power-up. That's me trying to better explain the point. And then Svetov Kalev commented just recently, right before me recording this, about Divine Circular Flow, why would you want this to train him? sorry. The technique itself is a feat that's unfathomable for regulars. It's not supposed to drain you. You seem to misunderstand what it is, though. What God of Guardians taught Baam is not a simple technique. It's a new way of controlling Shinsu. He opened Baam's eyes, so to speak. Obviously, he won't use the weak regular Shinsu control when he had learned the way to control Shinsu like the Ten Family Leaders and Zahard can. Also, Baam used the black hole technique when his body was on the verge of exhaustion. SIU in his afterword clearly stated that the technique is not in its final form yet. We can also look from Baum's perspective. He lost two companions because he was weak. It's natural for him to start using these overpowered techniques right away to perfect them and get stronger. Also about how Baam survived God of Guardians attacks in his thick plot armor. I believe you forget his monstrous Shinsu resistance as an irregular. Why would I want it to drain him? Because it's bad writing and a shitty story. If the character can shoot nukes and be like, okay, cool, I'm fine, nothing's going wrong. And yes, it takes Shinsu from outside of him and draws it into a point, but that has to take some effort on his part, or else there is no point in learning it. He could just sort of, like you said, open his eyes, he could sort of do it, and in which case it takes a ton of weight away from the series, because now Baam can just shoot, again, shoot nukes without caring. So, again, it makes it even worse when it doesn't drain him. Let's see. SIU stated it wasn't in its final form yet. Yeah, like I said earlier, he can improve it, but that still doesn't make what's happening now good. He still has no drawbacks. He still has nothing holding him back. It's still not very good. And looking from his perspective, losing two companions because he was weak, he did lose them, but it wasn't necessarily because he was weak. He obviously was weak compared to a Slayer, but he was not even going to be close to a Slayer right now anyway. So trying to make a huge, huge power jump and saying, this is all of my fault, isn't complete. It's skipping a lot. It's not building naturally, just building and building and building. It's jumping rather than building, and that's kind of what isn't too good for it. And for him using overpowered techniques right away, again, it's not very good writing. Also because he has thick plot armor. Yes, I'm not the only one that said this. Tons of people have been saying at this point Baam only survived that because of his plot armor. He has resistance as an irregular. But even though the God of Guardians was holding back, he talked about how badass it was, and it hurt Baam a lot. But basically, the point of saying that it's plot armor is that it's a very, very main character thing. Someone who isn't a main character of a show does not get to say, okay, hit me with the World Buster so I can learn it. So that's the problem, is that it was a generic sort of thing you sort of poop it out. It wasn't developed very much. Which again is sort of what I said in the comparison with the Rasen Shuriken. Zinzawiel said for the Karakador, to get to the God of Guardians the first time they used a warp or teleport. Sachi said it was uncertain where you'd end up. Most likely a special guardian, though we didn't expect the God of Guardians. The hidden and secret floor is weird, because I could never tell if it was the same as the Floor of Death, but everybody seems to know what the Floor of Death is. Now, while Ryun said that this isn't the real Floor of Death, it's inside the Dead Guardian, and others didn't seem to know that, which makes me think that the 43rd floor is the Floor of Death, and the interior of the Guardian is the hidden and secret floor. And yeah, I'll agree, it's always a bit vague whether or not the Floor of Death is the secret floor, but I'd say they're different, just because, like, my first of 2 points of why I'd say it was probably different is they say that the secret floor is at the end of the Hell Train, but it doesn't seem like this is the end of the Hell Train. It seems like the Hell Train keeps going from here. Secondly, it seems like the hidden floor wouldn't be, like, a numbered floor. The Floor of Death is Floor 43. It's just that normal regulars get to skip it because there's no administrator. So I feel like it would be like an area hidden between floors maybe, or just a hidden area somewhere, which means it's possibly the Floor of Death, the real inside the Guardian Floor of Death. But I don't know. I like to think it would be better if the hidden floor was something different. Next, they said, I'm not too fond of the Divine Circular flow either, but it's emphasized how special Baam is throughout the series due to being an irregular, which kind of makes it okay. The problem is we don't have enough training for his allies. Something like Kun and Andrassi just got from Evan and Yuri. That should happen more often, so it makes sense for his team to be able to keep up. And yeah, Baam is special. Just the story arc from the move, from being introduced to the move existing, to Baam learning the move, to Baam using the move. That is the story arc of learning an ability. That happened in 3-4 chapters, and it was really just weak and light. It was important, but didn't seem important. And not in a good way. They also said, the world building is amazing. I didn't expect it at all. 1 month of darkness, having to jump off the train since it's so hostile that nobody built a station there. The blood of the Guardian running between the mountains like an ocean. It's incredible. And yeah, I love the way the setting and design for the Floor of Death looked. It looked really scary and beautiful. Also, they said, Albelda can't leave the train anyway, can she? Though now that I think about it, Joaquin can, and he's in a similar situation. I'd say that Albelda should be able to leave as well, because Rachel said spells are nullified and Joaquin can leave. And if Joaquin can leave, I'd say Albelda can leave, because the rules should be the same for both of them. Rowan sealed the 5 siblings on the train, essentially, so the 5 siblings should have the same rules. It's just that Joaquin has 3 of the other siblings inside of him now, technically. Svetislav Kolev said, about the Thorn theory some time ago, I would have been a fan of it. The first time Beta spoke of it, I thought it was part of the Guardian's corpse, if not the entire thing, and that Baam would have a crazy weapon that holds the Guardian's power. Now I feel differently. The first point is that Enryu's a spearbearer, not a wave controller. He, of course, is considered the strongest wave controller since nobody matches his Shinsu control. But why a spearbearer, then? Because he levitates thousands of Shinsu spears? That's more of a wave controller sort of thing. My guess is that at this point, Enryu entered the tower with a weapon of extraordinary power. Probably a spear of some sort. Pobedal Gisteng spoke of the needle, how he wondered how strong it would be in the hands of an irregular. It suggests he knows something about it. Ilham Naim said, I was thinking the exact same thing. The whole Thorn is a part of the Guardian theory is really predictable. It would be a very interesting plotline if the Thorn is a powerful weapon, just broken into pieces because it was used to kill the Guardian. Maybe the Floor of Death Baam can fuse or fix the weapon and learn how to control or use it. And also, maybe that'll make Enryu come after Baam to get his weapon back. But theories aside, I'm so hyped for this arc. For me, both theories are good. I honestly like both of them. I like the theory that it's a part of the Guardian's corpse. That is a little bit predictable, like both of you said. I can kind of see that, just because so many people have said it. But despite it being a little predictable, I think it would be a very good storyline if Baam went, collected the thorns, brought the Guardian back to life, something like that. That'd be really cool. But now that you've said it, I also do really like your theory, because it'd be cool if Baam put the weapon back together and then Enryu showed up in the story just to get his weapon back. That would be really, really cool. Of course, it would kind of be like Baam makes this cool weapon and then bam, it gets taken away. But still, I think it would be very interesting and cool. Anime Watcher said, also, okay, this is something else I got to talk about for a bit. I just wanted to inform you that Baam Zahard on the Tower of God subreddit's forming up a Tower of God podcast, and I think you'd be interested. I'll contact Baam Zahard and tell him about your channel, and we'll see where it'll go from there. Okay, hold on. Let's talk about this for a bit, and let me get some water. So here's my issue. I really do wish the podcast the best. I hope it'll do great, and I'll likely be, if they do it week to week, I don't know how they're planning to do it. But I did check out the subreddit thread when you first commented that. So yeah, I'll probably be listening to it. But and yeah, shout-outs here. Shout-outs in my video. But I don't know. My problem with it is that recording that would be on a certain schedule. And like I have said earlier in this video even, I'm doing school full-time. I'm working most days like at least 12 hours on YouTube. sometimes I can, it's very rare that it takes me under 8 hours to do everything I need to do for YouTube for the day. But yeah, 8 to 12 hours usually every single day on YouTube, plus full-time school. So the thing is, I just don't know if I would be able to say, okay, this is my scheduled time, I'm going to go record that with them every single week. That said, maybe some week, they were talking about having guest appearances, maybe some week I wouldn't mind being up there or something, I don't know. But just basically, for me, I don't know. If you were talking, I think they already have enough people to host it anyway. It seems like it's just a group of them that they're friends over at the Tower of God Reddit that they're going to be doing it together, which I think works a lot better anyway since they all know each other previously and can talk like that. I think that works better anyway since they are already friends. So and I wouldn't want to intrude on that. So if they want me to be a guest up there or something sometime, then yeah, I'll see if I can. But when it comes to actually like doing it regularly, I don't know. I just don't know if I would have time with doing both school and YouTube, because I'm already behind on some videos, trying to do more videos. And while I'd honestly love to do a podcast, just because there are so many YouTubers doing it nowadays, and I think it'd be really cool. It'd be opening me up to a bigger audience and everything. But yeah, and I even tried to do it once before. I talked back when there were two other channels doing Tower of God videos, and I talked to those two other channels, and I think I maybe even brought it up to Yudazuya White Bear Beppo, because even though he makes mostly AMVs and stuff and just One Piece stuff, but he comments here pretty often, so I feel like I've talked to him a little bit in the comments. I even brought it up to him. I was like, yo, maybe I'll try to get this together. But things just fell through because the other two people doing Tower of God videos stopped making videos, and things just didn't work. And with this, I'm not saying that it won't work, because there's definitely a good chance they can get it to work, but I'm saying it probably wouldn't work for me. And holy crap, I'm just looking at the time recording, it's over an hour. Of course it is. But yeah, the HaQ&A is my weekly one-man podcast talking to you about stuff in the comments. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'll talk to him. You said you'd inform him that my channel exists. Maybe I'll talk to him and see if they want to have me up there as a guest sometime. Maybe, but I don't know, just because of scheduling and time and all that. And I think that's it. But no, I have a notification for another comment. Let's see what we got here. Hang on. Let's go ahead and add this in. We're already over an hour. Screw it. Ilham Naeem said, I don't think that the secret door has got anything to do with the hidden floor. If it did, wouldn't Karaka know about it or figure it out? I thought he lives on the hidden floor. I don't remember that, but maybe that's something to look into. No, Karaka lives on like the 80-somethingth floor, because remember we saw Karaka's palace. It's like the 80-somethingth floor or something like that. Or maybe the 78th, I don't know, some floor up there, or a 78th The Wall Hike song, something like that, but somewhere up there. They said also, is the train the only way to get to the 43rd floor? Do normal regulars who are not on the train simply give the 42nd floor test and skip to the 44th? I think that's the way it works, because we saw when Baam and them didn't catch the train, they just took normal tests to get to the next floor, and the normal test they just went up by suspendership as usual. And I think that's the way it would work. You pass the normal 42nd floor test and the ship just takes you to the 44th. Also, if Yuri's caught breaking many rules, who would punish her? Pretty much Zahard. I'm not sure that anybody else could. I mean, Yuri's pretty strong, so even if they sent one of her sisters after her, well, I guess that's technically how it works, because when Eurasia N and Garam, I believe, were the two that went rogue. When they went rogue, they sent squads of like RED members and princesses after them. So I guess if she did break a bunch of rules and there was going to be somebody that had to capture, it would probably be a group of princesses / RED members. Also, so many questions and so much hype. I'm probably going to go insane before the arc finishes. It's going to be so good. And especially, we're all going to go insane. If SIU does take a break mid-arc, that would be the shit. Not the shit as in a good way, but the shit as in, man, he needs the break for his health, but man, will it bother us reading. But either way, freaking hour-long video. I really tried to make this video not this long, but I knew it was going to be long this week. But either way, I don't mind it. Like I said, if the HaQ&As are like my monthly one-man podcast, then screw it. It's the way things are. But either way, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I really, really do. I guess like if you'd like the video. I'll be back for the next one next week. Comment down there anything you want to talk about next week, anything you thought about what I said here and whatnot. Subscribe for more of everything we talked about here and a bunch more. Follow on Twitter if you want, and I'll try to keep you updated there and stuff for the channel. That's it, so thank you once again for watching, and I'll see you all next time.